So one thing I don't know that we covered a whole lot when we talked about inheritance, other than what was in the textbook, is the idea of an abstract class. So I wanted to touch on that, and this is a pretty good example here. So say that we want to create some software that's going to draw shapes. It's going to draw ovals, and it can also draw rectangles. And so, you know, of course, we could sit down and go, okay, we'll create an oval class and we'll create a rectangle class. But if we sit and think about it, the way that we can draw shapes, distinguish shapes, is to define them by two points. So we could keep, according to this, because I'm not great at geometry, if we know two points, then we can, if we're told to draw a rectangle and we have two of the points, we can draw the rectangle. If we're told to draw an oval and we've got two points, we can draw that. And maybe we want to also like let them be different colors and things like that. So yes, in theory, we could create these two different classes, but they've got some things in common. So what if we decided that we were going to do inheritance, and we were going to pull out the things they have in common and put them in a parent class and then have two child classes? We could do that. Now, the thing is, say we created a class called Shape, and we put some of the characteristics that they all have in common in Shape. But the reality is, we're never going to say draw a shape. We're either going to draw a rectangle or we're going to draw an oval, right? We're never going to draw a generic shape. I mean, what would we even mean by that? So we might want to set up an inheritance relationship, but we know we're never going to do like shape XYZ equals new shape. We have no reason to really create a shape object or ever instantiate it, because it doesn't make sense from a programming main method standpoint to do that. So we can still create the shape class and the two child classes. We can still establish the parent and child relationship. But if we know we're never going to create a shape object, we can actually make that shape class abstract, which means we're never going to create an object of that type, but we want to have it as a class. We want to have it as a parent to some children. But we don't ever want to actually, and we want it to have the common characteristics, but we never want to create an object of that type. So this is a special type of inheritance relationship where we're going to declare a class as abstract, put the common characteristics in it, and then have the actual child classes that we're going to instantiate and use. Now, abstract classes often have at least one abstract method. But they don't have to. They can have fields, and they can have methods with code or bodies in them, and they can have abstract methods, which is a method that has a declaration but no code in the body. And we'll talk about that in a second. So here they've set up simple shape, and notice this is kind of like one of the diagrams I showed you when I was talking about an inheritance diagram, where we've got a rectangle with three sections to it. The first is the name of the class. The second holds all the instance variables that are in that class. So by looking at this diagram, I know I have point one, point two in color. Usually they'll put the data types there as well. And I know it has one method called draw. And then here, again, because I've got the solid lines coming up with the open arrow, if you remember in another lecture I did, I talked about that showing an is a inheritance relationship. So line is a simple shape, oval is a simple shape, rectangle is a simple shape, and this means that line extends simple shape, oval extends simple shape, and rectangle extends simple shape. So that's our inheritance relationship there. Notice that each of these, we don't have any new instance variables. They are all going to leverage off of point one, point two in color from the parent. They don't have any of their own instance variables per this diagram, but they each override the draw method. They each have their own implementation, their own code specific to that shape in the draw method. So what we could do in the parent is we could say, you know, I don't want to put any code in here. I'm going to make this an abstract method, meaning it's not going to have any code because a line is drawn differently than an oval, which is drawn differently than a rectangle. So it really doesn't make sense for me to have any code in the draw method here, but I want to make sure that I sort of enforce the idea that each of the children will have a method name draw. I want them all to use that method with their own code. This is probably sounding kind of similar to the idea of an interface, kind of a similar concept here. So this one may not have any code, but I don't want line to say have a method called draw line, and somebody who creates the oval class says, I'm just going to call it draw oval, and the person who creates the rectangle class says, I'm going to call it draw R. I want them all to follow the same naming convention of having a draw method. They will just each implement their own code depending on which type of shape is being drawn. So that's the benefit. If I can put a method here where I don't put code, but I'm kind of cluing in the children that I really want you each to have your own method name draw. So we've got consistency no matter which type of object it is, and I want you to put your own code in there. This is a really nice example of that. So if we had this class of shape, we would use the word abstract when we set it up. That would indicate that we could never do simple shape XYZ equals new simple shape. It would not let us do that because it's abstract. And then we could set up an abstract draw method in it as well. Now this site has horrible color scheme going on here and is not necessarily the best example, but I just wanted to show you to set up an abstract class, you actually put public abstract class and then the class name. So after the word public goes the keyword abstract to indicate that is an abstract class. Remember, this is a special kind of inheritance. So if I'm going to create an abstract class, I'm going to expect that somewhere I have a child that is extending from that class. And notice this is the same as it always is. Public class, subclass name, extends, parent or abstract class name. So nothing changes there. And I also want you to see that any of these methods, given the relationship between, in this case, they're using shape and circle and square. So if we have an abstract class called shape, we can't do shape C equals new shape, but what we can do is shape C equals new circle, which is a child of shape. We can do shape circle equals new circle. We can do shape square equals new square. All of those are valid. So while you cannot do shape equals new shape, you can definitely do shape equals new child class circle or square. So just be aware, or you can actually set it equal to null. That's valid too. So even though you can't declare an instance of an abstract class, you can still use the child constructor to create an object. So this is going to be a circle object, but we're using the circle constructor, and we're going to use the circle draw method and so on. And we're going to call it circle, but we can leverage off of that abstract class name shape. So I know that's a little tricky, but those are all valid because of the parent-child relationships between circle, square, and shape. And then finally, I wanted you to see how to declare an abstract class. So notice here we've got an abstract class, graphic object. I wanted you to see how to declare an abstract method. So if I wanted to declare that draw method, similar to the other example, I would just put the method name, or sorry, I'd put abstract, the return type, and then the method name with paren paren and semicolon. So again, this is probably looking a lot like an interface, right? Because we have the method name with no code, and then we have paren paren semicolon after it. And then in the subclasses, we would actually have, you know, public void draw, paren paren, open brace, code, 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 close brace, okay? So we put the implementation of the draw method in each subclass. And notice here, abstract classes cannot be instantiated, but they can be subclassed, meaning I'm not going to create a graphic object method standalone. I'm going to create children or subclasses of it, and then I can do, you know, graphic class XYZ equals new circle or something like that. And again, here, when abstract classes have subclasses, the subclass usually provides the implementation for all the abstract methods in the parent class. And so for purposes of the AP exam, that's really just what you need to know. Here we're talking about an abstract class being compared to an interface. With abstract classes, you can declare fields that are not static and final, and you can declare public protected methods. Now remember, with interfaces, all fields were automatically public, so we didn't have to put the word public anywhere. They were automatically public, static, and final, and all the methods were automatically public, so we never had to put public, void, whatever. Okay. Now remember that one of the differences between inheritance and interfaces, a class can implement multiple interfaces. So class X implements comparable, comma, measurable, comma, and on, however many interfaces it wants to implement. But when we have inheritance, class A extends class B. You can't extend multiple. You can't say extends class B, comma, class C, class D, etc. Can only extend one time. And then they have a little good overview here. When should you use an abstract class or an interface? This is all out on the Java Oracle website, and I will send you the link to this, but just want to make sure that you had the idea of an abstract class in mind in case you see it on the AP exam.